have several, and we want to continue to make sure that we keep updated on those. I know a couple surgeons this week. Bev is with us. She had cataract surgery. She's doing well. Betty Strope back with us. No glasses. She's doing well. So we're happy to hear that. Jeanette Moore. Jeannie's not with us. But she did come through her lipotripsy well. They did not find any cells, so that's news. She's going through a lot, but that is one step at least in the right direction for her. We definitely praise God for those. Family camp, for those who attended, seemed like a great week. Though it was hot, we still had good attendance and turnout. And there were several. John Irvin's been on the prayer list, had some heart surgery. He's doing well, so we praise for that, and we praise that great week. And also Brett Corcoran survived. He's with us somewhere. He deemed a week at camp. I'm so proud of him, and he did a great job. And I think so. The kids loved him, and he's here in one piece. So he did a great job. We're happy for that. So a lot of praises. We want to mention again. If you have updates, additions, let us know to keep us posted as to the names that are on there, and to help us with keeping up with that list. But we also want to keep in prayers Mike Jones. I don't know if many of you. If you're familiar with the Sabina Church of Christ, Mike is an elder there, 59 years of age. Yesterday they had a softball tournament, played, started to not feel so well, and so he sat under a tree. He told his family, I'm going to go ahead and head home. And later that day, his wife found him dead. Sudden heart attack. So 59 years old, no complications. It just happened. So folks, I cannot stress enough the importance of making Christ a part of your life and making sure that we have a relationship with him, because we don't know what tomorrow may hold for us. So we've got to make sure that we at least have the heavenly perspective of things, because anything can happen. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. A busy morning. I'll finish up the announcements. We'll turn it over to Ken, and then we'll run right through this morning. Father, we come before you. Thank you so very much for the day you've given us. Another time where we gather together and worship you and sing praises to your name. And Father, as we continue through the summer, as we move forward, and knowing how you blessed this church for so many years, I pray that we all work together to serve you, that we find where we're best suited at, and as we work together to further your kingdom, and when we leave the doors this morning in our everyday lives, we do our very best to shine your light for all to see. And Father, I just thank you for the praises we received this morning. It is so, what an absolute privilege to know when you answer our prayers, and we just want to thank you and praise you for our answered prayers. And also the names of the list, the needs and concerns. I just pray for those who've lost loved ones or battling illness, Father, as we lift these names up to you this morning. Be with us the remainder of the service. Guide us, keep us safe, and to your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. A couple of announcements real quick as we move forward. Our sexual attendance, 65, so still in the 60s. Hopefully as summer approaches or fall approaches, we'll get back to where we were around the 70s or 80s. But I know Ken has a couple announcements. The only thing I think I have, too, oh, it wouldn't be an announcement without a clipboard. Shirley is pointing to the clipboard. She means business. There are a sign-up sheet. Sid and Judy have served the Lord for 37 years, and they're continuing to serve the Lord in some capacity. But plus years here at this church, and August the 6th, this Saturday, we are honoring that as a celebration and a memory for the service and then the work that he's done. So if you plan on attending from 2 to 5 here at the church, honoring their work, we have a sign-up sheet, please make an effort to meet them. It should be a good time of fellowship. I know many people traveling come in, and so just to respect what he's done, he's really made an impact, especially when you think of the ministers who are here at this church. 20-plus years at one church, that's pretty remarkable. The half-life of the minister doesn't last very long sometimes in one church, but he's impacted a lot of lives here in this community. So please make an effort to be there. If your name is not on the sign-up sheet, Shirley is going to yell at me, so please don't. Please make an effort to sign up on that sheet. If you want to be a greeter or serve in some capacity, special music, again, we have the sign-up sheets there. Just let us know whether it's preparing communion or things. If you want to serve in any way, we will get you plugged in. So please keep those things in mind. I have nothing else. I know Ken's excited. We had a couple of baptisms in camp this week, which is pretty good. I just want to say one thing. The vestry here, Nathan was baptized this week in camp. Now, let me say something. As a minister, you're very honored when something is done in your memory. For instance, I did not know this, but the fair, you guys had a show turkey, right? And you named him Klaus. What place did he come in? It wasn't first. That's on that as he gets the announcement.
Good morning. So some real other quick announcements. Don't forget, Saturday we'll be leaving at noon for anybody that wants to go down to Young's Dairy with us. So anybody's more than any of the kids are more than welcome to come, but be here by noon and we'll take off. Also on Tuesday, Austin Palmer will be going to Children's to have some more tests done on his arm, so we want to keep Austin and the rest of the family in the prayers as he goes and gets that. We've got, like Brad said, some baptisms to take care of. Heather, you want to come up? And Nathan and Megan.
Your mic's not working. No, it is.
Megan, I just found out about Friday night after it happened. So, Megan, I do not have your Bible yet. It will be here next week, so I will give it to you. But here is your certificate of baptism. Nathan, I knew about because you've been wanting to do this for a while. So, Nathan, I've got your Bible and your certificate. And Heather was baptized a couple of weeks ago, and I've got her baptismal certificate and also her Bible.
Don't get caught up in that. Don't be a part of it. You're going to good way. So if you're talking bad about somebody, you don't want them to talk bad about you. So guys, really think about it as you head back to school or when you're playing with friends. So be nice. So always treat people the way you want to be treated. Because you'll find out you'll have a lot more friends than if you do it the other way. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for always being there for us. Lord, we thank you for loving us. And we just pray for your strength to be able to treat people the way we want to be treated. And we pray that we always put you first. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Are you guys ready to sing? Sunday, so anybody that's celebrating an anniversary in the month of August, come on up. Standing. If you don't know the anniversary blessing, it's in the front of the hymnal. We'll go ahead and repeat that together. May you have many more years together as husband and wife, and may Christ also be in the center of your life. Although you may have many burdens to bear, may the Lord also send many blessings for you to share. Let's go ahead and greet one another.
As long as message, which is I Have Sinned. So we're going to be singing about God's grace and the way he has saved us this morning. Our next song will be 368. We'll sing the first and third of He Lives.
here this morning seeking to praise and worship you, Lord, and to bring you all that praise. Lord, I just thank you for all the great things that you've been doing in this congregation and all the baptisms, Lord. And Lord, I would just pray that we continue to be ministers to those and help them, Lord, as they start their service to you and as they go into schools and workplaces and witness for you, Lord, and to bring you, Lord. Lord, bless our time now together as we hear Brad's sermon. And Lord, just help us touch us and help us receive the church better. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen.
Our prayers are for our evening and this morning. We'll sing 321, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Lately, we used a passage Paul's letter to Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 7 through 13. Of this gospel, I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though, I am the very least of all the saints. This grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the plan of the mystery hidden in for ages, and God who created all things, that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the principalities, the powers in the heavenly places. This is according to the eternal purpose which he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and confidence of access to our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is to your glory. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, once again we come to you with hope in our hearts and joy in our souls to ask your blessings of all that we undertake to do to serve you. We ask for forgiveness for our sins. We also ask that you watch over our service people, guide them, and protect them as they serve the greatest nation on this planet. Bless all those who serve him through the New Vienna Church of Christ. Amen.
Over the years, people have debated when God said in the Old Testament, I want you to give me 10%. Anything over and above that, you can consider an offer. And of course, the New Testament has nothing about it. You don't do your tithe. Ran across this in Proverbs. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing. Sounds like a promise to me. No, you don't see the word tithe in the New Testament. But if we love the Lord, we don't stop there. We go beyond. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you because you have blessed us and loved us. And we ask for your help in maintaining a life that you are approved of. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Before I preach, Jake Skinner, who's here, has just a couple of words he'd like to share with you. So, Jake, if you want to come forward and share that.
Church. I kind of got away from church.
Lord, but it takes a great deal of humility, as we've touched on this entire month, when it comes to prayer, to come before God, whether it's walking down this aisle or coming before a bunch of people and giving testimony. And we look at the importance of prayer as we bring our sermon series to a close this month in Psalm 51. It says, I have sinned. Some of you are thinking that's a message about me, but partly, yes, as a whole. But Psalm 51 is such a beautiful psalm. And before we do dive into the message this morning, I want to give recognition to someone who is here. Liz Tissot, who has been with us for some time and has been so nervous. She's been just absolutely nervous because she's had to stay far, right? What is it? Anyway, I'm a preacher, I don't know these things. Anyway, she had a test, all right? But she was very nervous. Well, she passed with flying colors, so we're going to take it. Don't ask her if you can get free medication, okay? Because I already have. I just need some Flonase. That's it. I don't know how to get a copay. Psalm 51, we're happy for listening. Psalm 51 is what we'll be looking at. And I think it's very important as we continue looking at the Old Testament prayers. And we've seen Moses in his prayer that God's presence be with him. We've looked at Hannah in 1 Samuel. We've seen her prayer of how so badly she wanted a child. And God blessed her with that child. And she turned around and gave that child back. We've also seen prayer last week of Solomon, David's son. And a very simple prayer, give me wisdom. But I believe this prayer that David gives is one of the most effective but yet difficult prayers in Scripture. To admit we've sinned. I have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. King David was a man after God's own heart. But he was still a man. And we know each and every one of us face temptations daily. Struggles and circumstances that we know sometimes we fall short. But many people would look at David and think, a man after God's own heart, being very quick to judge and say, how in the world could this happen? How could a man so faithful fall to the temptation in his life? Well, we know better than anything the effects that sin has on our life, and we've been there and done that, and we know how it's possible. David sinned, and we know the effects of sin in our lives. Psalm 51 is a psalm of repentance that David writes, but we see what takes place in 2 Samuel. You don't have to turn there, but give you an idea of what took place in chapter 12. We see David confronted with what he had committed, the sin in which he had done. God sent his messenger Nathan in 2 Samuel chapter 12 to confront David with what took place. If you remember the life of David, we know that an idle mind wanders. And he was in his kingdom and he looks down from his rooftop and he sees a beautiful woman and she's bathing. He lusts upon Bathsheba. What happens next? He lets that lust out of control and he commits adultery with Bathsheba. Then to hide that sin and to make matters worse, he then sends Bathsheba's husband, Uriah, to the front of the battle. And if you know anything about the front of the battle, you weren't going to make it. Uriah was killed in battle. So now David has not only committed adultery, but he's committed murder. And then to act as if it would be okay and sleeping under the rug, he then marries Bathsheba as if the guilt of sin will go away. But we know that that to be not the case. For a year, David battled the guilt of sin. For a year, it ate away at him. We commit sins, and though we try to ignore the consequences and put it away, guilt will eat away in our lives. David lived under intense guilt. So here's Nathan. He tells this parable, and he says there's this rich man who had plenty of lambs to offer as sacrifices, but there's this poor man who had one lamb. He takes that lamb, the rich man does. And David is indignant. He says, listen, Nathan, this guy deserves to be killed. He deserves to be punished. Who is this rich guy? Who does he think he is? Nathan says, buddy, it's you. You've taken what isn't yours. David is immediately confronted with what he's been trying to hide for a year. David begins to fully acknowledge that he's sinned against God. Listen, God knows our hearts. So as much as we try to hide it from other people around us, and we try to do our very best to keep it hidden, he knows what we're doing in our lives. He knows what we're dealing with. He knows our struggles, the temptations we face. We can't hide from God. The guilt of sin can be a terrible thing. The guilt of sin is terrifying. It's horrible. It eats away at us. But you know what's even greater? God's mercy. You see, as sinful as we may think we are, and many people will say that, you know, I don't feel worthy to come to church, or boy, I'm a bad person. If I came to the church doors, it would cave in. You know, the walls would set ablaze. But God's mercy is much greater when we confront our sin and confess it and know what He offers. And though we are guilty, clearly, God does not want us to drown in our guilt. If we're Christians this morning, we know that we have made Christ a part of our life. We've been baptized. We have the gift of the Holy Spirit. But we know that His personal presence dwells within us. God is pursuing us daily. His Spirit is convicting us, and His Word speaks to us. The problem is, as we've talked about this entire month, we do not take the time to seek God daily as we should. 1 John 1:9 tells us, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. We're going to fall short. We're going to stumble. But the beauty of Christianity is we have an advocate in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Someone we know that when we are promised forgiveness, when we seek repentance and confession of sin. You see, Psalm 51 is a beautiful psalm, but it's very humbling to us. It's very humbling to admit we've done wrong. Sometimes, as hard as we try to hide it, and finally it has to come to the forefront. But as we see in David's prayer, I want you to know this morning, if you get anything from this message, that if you seek to be restored in the presence of God, if you seek restoration, I want you to know that that path is woven with repentance. That path is woven with the confession of what we've done. And if we refuse to repent of our sins, I want you to know that the consequences are much greater than physical and what happens here on earth. But there's eternal consequences to unconfessed sin in our lives. There's great consequences to ignoring habits of sin unless we repent before God. And I believe we see how severe sin is in our lives and the importance of confessing that sin to God and seeking repentance in this psalm. And there are three things that I want us to touch on this morning that we find in Psalm 51 that help us have the very same mindset that David had when it comes to confronting what we've done. I have sinned. That three-letter statement is so hard for people to say. But all of us need to realize that we are sinners merely saved by God's grace. Psalm 51, beginning with verse 1, notice what David writes. He says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. Save me from blood guilt, O God, the God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. There's so much in this psalm that we see David beginning to pour his heart out. Because David is struggling just as we do today when it comes to sin in our lives and how we are to handle it. The first thing that I want you to know this morning, when it comes to this prayer that David gives and how we seek repentance before the presence of God, is this. We need to understand our sin in relation to God. We need to understand our sin in relation to the God who has loved us so much that He sent Christ to die for our sins. Verse 1 is a very humbling statement. Have mercy on me, O God. Once we're convicted of sin, we realize the need we have for God's mercy. You learn in life very quickly that sometimes when you commit wrong, the easiest thing to do is say yes. Yes, you did. I'm amazed at our athletes and movie stars who, you know, get caught up in something very immoral. It's clearly evident as you watch television and the days progress and they have excuse after excuse when really, if they just come clean, it won't be as bad. Now, granted, the consequences don't go away, but just admit you've done wrong. Sometimes we have a way of putting off the sin in our lives. When God convicts of a sin, we have a way of trying to blame other people. Well, what me? It was the people I associate myself with. Or it was the wrong place at the wrong time, God. Not necessarily me, but the others around me. Or we try to rationalize what we've done. Well, there's a reason why I committed this act. And we try to pass the excuse and we pass the buck off. But at the end of the day, when God convicts us of something, the easiest thing to say is yes. The easiest thing for us is to admit that we have sinned. We cannot be forgiven unless we just confess what we've done. Now, I think it's interesting because in this psalm, David not only seeks mercy because he realizes who he is, he's a sinner, but he's acknowledging who God is. Notice verse 1 again, and notice what he gives God, the titles. He says, according to your notice, unfailing love and your great compassion. David is acknowledging how good God is. God never fails his people. Never. There is not a time in any of our lives where God fails us. But we as his people fail him. We as his people stumble and fall short. God is always faithful to his word. He keeps his word. He keeps his promises. And he never lets us down. As a matter of fact, when David gives this description, we know all the way back in Exodus when God reveals himself to the people of Israel and he declares the law and what it is, he tells them, listen, I'm a compassionate God. I'm a merciful God. Nehemiah 9:17, I love what the prophet writes. He says, you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in love. I think we all can agree how grateful we are that God is patient with us. Because I don't know about you, but I'd get bent out of shape with me real quick. In high school, I loved my grammar teacher, Mrs. Magus. She was the sweetest woman. But, you know, the book report was due. We would make excuse after excuse as to why we didn't do it. But then we just said, listen, we didn't do it. But do you want to hear the excuse we had as to why we didn't do it? She didn't fly. It didn't matter where the excuse was. The purpose was we didn't do the assignment. We admitted wrong. But, you know, when we think of admitting wrong before God, we know how merciful he is because he tells us he never fails in love. There's never a moment where he's rationing his love out. It's always abundant. God never fails. But it's we as his people who come up short. Lamentations 3:22 says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. David immediately acknowledges who God is, and then notice in verses 2 and 3, notice the pronoun my. Now, we live in a society today that is me, myself, and I. We sing in the key of me, 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 right? It's pride-driven. But sometimes there is an acknowledgement to use this pronoun, especially when it comes to what we've done before God. David says this in verse 2, wash away all my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. That pronoun sometimes is hard to say when we actually admit wrongdoing. David was conscious of his sin in the presence of God, and he took full responsibility. A whole year, guilt had eaten away at him. He comes clean. There's no longer can I do this. He made no excuses. He realized what he had done, committing adultery, committing murder, and then hiding it for so long. For I know my transgressions. You know, AA meetings tell you that the first step to getting over an addiction is admitting we have a problem. We cannot seek restitution before God and forgiveness until we admit we have a problem. We have sinned. That's why he says, wash me, blot out my iniquities, cleanse me. That cannot come unless there's an admittance of what we've done. Pride gets in the way of a lot of things. And we've all been bitten by the pride bug, right? We all have it. And we try to be the most humble people, but even sometimes, pride just seems to get in the way in some way, shape, or form. I recall Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve having a problem with pride. We know what happened. God says, listen, you guys can eat anything, have anything, just don't eat this tree, okay? Go do what you do, name the animals, I don't know, but don't mess with this tree, don't eat it. Here comes the serpent. Chapter 3. What does Eve do? Oh, the serpent begins to say, yeah, God really said you need to eat the tree. I mean, this is so bad. Then, you know, God doesn't want you to be like God. He doesn't want like him. So he's like, oh, I'll eat it. And, you know, we give a bad rap because we think of a woman. Well, you're stupid. Don't eat that. Guys, we're just stupid because Adam and Eve. Now, we see both eat of what they shouldn't have ate. And then what happens? The shame is revealed. That harmony that God intended man to have is gone. That's why we face physical death, but we also have to face the consequences of sin. Adam and Eve didn't hide because they hear God coming. God knows what they've done. He's not stupid. God realizes he's all-knowing. But you know what they did? Eve says, well, that serpent came along and deceived me. I didn't really understand what the serpent was saying. You know what Adam did? He blamed the woman. You see, from the beginning of time, there was a blame game. We can't blame other people. We can't blame other circumstances. We cannot blame how we were raised because we are sinners and we are in need of God's grace if we do not have Christ a part of our lives. David acknowledged who God was in relation to who he was. when it comes to what he had done sin-wise. He took personal responsibility, but he also acknowledged that he had sinned against God. The second thing I want you to point out this morning from this passage is not only understanding sin in our relation to God, but he personally acknowledged that he had sinned against God. Again, we can't seek mercy without an acknowledgement of what we've done. But David could not ignore the fact any longer. Hold your place and just turn over with me to Psalm 32. Psalm 32. Verses 3 through 5. I think the Psalms, when you read them, are very candid. People will ask, when it comes to devotion, where do I begin reading the Scripture? I always tell people, read a chapter of the Gospels, but read Psalm. The book of Psalms has so many practicalities for us in life. And they're very candid. David and other writers are very emotional and very honest with what they're dealing with. David was very honest in the description he gives in Psalm 32, is what he was feeling as he tried to continue to ignore the guilt of what had taken place with Bathsheba and Uriah. He mentions in 32, beginning of verse 3, this is what he says. What a description. He says, "When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For night and day your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." It eats away until we acknowledge I've sinned against you. That's the greatest, the worst aspect of when it comes to sin in our lives. The greatest thing we deal with is not the people that affect us, sure, and who we hurt, absolutely. But the worst part is that we've sinned against a holy God who loves us so much that he sent Christ to take away our sins. And we hurt God, we grieve God, when we continue to live in a lifestyle that is contrary to how he lays out his word. See, when we wrap our minds around that, knowing that his presence dwells within us, his Holy Spirit, and that his presence is there for a reason, to guide us, to convict us, to direct us in life, but we certainly can't ignore that Spirit. There can be no true cleansing without a confession to God. Now many people will say, well, what exactly is a confession of sin? Now many people would say, confession that we give before someone is baptized, that's a good confession. Peter, you know, Jesus asks, "Who am I?" "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." We see that. But a confession of sin, the Greek word is homologio. The idea is to speak as one. And that means when our attitude toward ourselves is one of recognition of guilt, we are speaking as one or agreeing with God about our sin. God knows we're sinners and he knows what we've done. When we confess our sins, we are in essence saying, "God, you are holy, I have sinned against you." We are acknowledging what we've done. 1 John 1:8 tells us, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So who are you fooling? Who are we fooling when it comes to the life we live? We're sinners. We're sinners saved by grace. And when we have this attitude, and as David did, and acknowledging that I've sinned against you, Lord, then we can be forgiven. As Isaiah 1:18 tells us, "Though your sins are as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow." You know, sin is a pretty filthy thing, and it leaves some nasty scars. But we know we are washed white as snow by the wonderful grace that Jesus provided. That when we mess up and we seek repentance, it can be found in our Savior and Lord. David says in verse 4, "Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight." You know, this confession of sin is of greatest value when it's before God. Many people do wrong and they will confess to the person they've wronged. That's good. It takes a lot of courage to tell someone, "Listen, I'm wrong. I'm sorry." That's really hard. Trust me, it really is. And then people will confess to their family and friends or a loved one, "I got to talk to you. I've been doing this and I got to get this off my chest." And that goes a long way. It does. And it's good to have people you can rely upon and have a shoulder to cry on or someone to talk to. Many people in the evangelical world today will confess to the priest. "Listen, I've sinned and I've done this wrong." We think of a confessional booth and we think the priest will take care of it from here. "Thanks, guy." And it's relayed up to God. But you know, the one person that we should be confessing our sins to is the Lord. He's the one we seek mercy. He's the one that is unfailing in his love and we seek forgiveness from him. Proverbs 28:13 tells us, "He who conceals his sin does not prosper. But whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy." David gives a very candid, unguarded admission of his sin against God. And whenever we sin, we need to realize first and foremost that we have sinned against the Lord. And we also need to know that unless we confess our sins and seek to make things right before God, there are terrible consequences to unconfessed sin in our lives. You see, not only do we understand sin in relation to who God is, or we personally acknowledge that we sinned against the Lord, the third and final thing I want to focus on this morning is that we need to realize that our sin separates us from God. Our sin separates us from the Lord who loves us so much. Nathan confronts David in a very confrontational manner. He's pretty bold. I mean, Nathan was probably a little hesitant. What's David going to do to me, you know? God's promised that he'll be with me, but it's still a little uneasy, you know? A little nerve-wracking. And he says, buddy, it's you. You're the one that this parable represents. You've committed sin. You must make this right. So we see Nathan confronting David, and David having a realization, most importantly, of how his relationship with God has been affected. God never failed David. Understand that this morning, but it is us who fail God. David failed God. And when we ignore sin in our lives, we are ignoring God's presence. Now, you may be here this morning and you don't know Christ. You are ignoring the importance of a decision to making Jesus a part of your life. You have a sin problem. And the consequences are eternal. And we know the results of what happens when we do not see Christ in our lives. There's one or two places we're going. Let's just be honest. But as Christians, we know that there are grave consequences when we allow sin to continue to fester within our hearts and to take root without acknowledging it and confessing it. Because pretty soon, much like yeast, it rises and it consumes us and it overtakes our lives. And we must seek God for repentance. Ephesians 4:30 tells us, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Don't ignore God's presence. But I want you to know, as great as God's grace is and as present as He is in our lives and He gives us His Word, we can choose to ignore it. We can choose to ignore His presence. And we can choose by free will to ignore His conviction in our lives. But understand the results of unconfessed sin are so grave. When you read verses 11 through 15, David lists them. He says it takes away the joy of salvation. The joy that we're supposed to have as Christians is zapped because we can't shake that sin in our lives. It even destroys our Christian witness. As David says, listen, I will be able to teach transgressors their ways and lead people to you as soon as I deal with my stuff. Why do you think people call us hypocrites daily? Because we do one thing on a Sunday morning, and when we leave the doors, we act much different than what we profess to be. We claim to be something, but we're not walking the walk. That's what people call us hypocrites. And they have every right to. But we see, David, listen, I'll be able to help restore other people once I take care of myself. But he says the song of praise is gone. The joy, the praise that he has is completely wiped away. When we ignore sin blatantly in life and refuse to address it and confess it before God, we are in essence choosing to separate ourselves gradually from God. There are many people in the evangelical world today, even in the Churches of Christ, Christian Church, that believe you can never lose your salvation. I don't think God will ever take our salvation away. Scripture tells us. As Romans 8 says, neither powers nor principalities, anything is there, can take us away or separate us from your great love. But you know what? We have the decision to turn away from that. We have the free will. And when you choose to continue living blatantly in sin, you are choosing to turn from God. And again, the consequences are great. You may be here this morning, and for years or months, days, I don't know, but something has been eating in your heart. You've been living life in a way that you know is not pleasing to God. You've been living in a way that you know that Scripture clearly tells us that is wrong in God's eyes. And we know that we're sinning against Him, but we can't shake it. And we think that the longer we put it in the back burner and we distract our mind and we slip it under the rug, things will be okay. But you know, as David expresses, the guilt will continue to eat away and gnaw at you unless you realize the importance of confessing your sin before God and making it right. David showed a great deal of humility in what he did. And as great as our sin may be, I want you this morning to understand that God's grace is greater. In Isaiah 43:25, he tells us, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. David confessed his sins before the presence of God while expressing the desire to make a complete break from sin. You can repent all day long. You can repent day after day. But if you do not make a commitment to not live in that way anymore, then your repentance is a bunch of false words to God. It doesn't mean a whole lot to God if you don't forsake that sin in your life. If we're going to confess, then we must forsake that sin. David claimed forgiveness because not only did he seek forgiveness before God, but his life was evident of it. You see, in verses 16 and 17, he says, listen, you delight in sacrifices. I can give sacrifice after sacrifice, but what you really delight in is a humble heart that is willing to live a life that's pleasing to you. Folks, this morning, David's prayer is a prayer that we've all have prayed at once, or we need to pray. And that's we've sinned. We've sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when we seek the mercy of God as David did, we are promised forgiveness through the blood of Jesus Christ. And no matter what you've done this morning, no matter how you've lived, it doesn't matter. You find complete restoration before the cross of Jesus Christ if you just make a willingness to seek Him this morning.
Amen.
God promises 100% forgiveness. Now that doesn't mean a relief from any of the consequences of sin. You see, sin has effects. And though He forgives us, we've got to live with those consequences. That's why it's so important, all of us, to understand we're making wise decisions. David and Bathsheba committed a terrible sin, and their first child became suddenly ill and died as a result of the sin they committed. We know their second son to be Solomon, and how he even had his foibles and stumbled and fell. And we saw last week how Solomon lived his life, knowing the example David gave. Though the consequences may remain there, it's so important this morning to understand. Now is the time for repentance. Now is the time to make things right before God and seek Him. Yeah, the scars of sin are pretty nasty, and sometimes we look back at life and we realize, boy, that's what I've done, you know? I've done some pretty bad things, but you know what's great? We don't have to live in the past. We live in the present. And in Jesus Christ, we are completely forgiven and made right. My prayer this morning is that we as God's people have the same attitude towards sin as David did. And if there be anybody here this morning who has lived in a way that they confess sin or they've tried to hide it, that this morning they see God's presence and they make it right before Him. Let's pray. We come before you this morning and we see David's prayer and his psalm of repentance, and we see how humbling it must have been when finally we realize and we acknowledge what we've done wrong, but how relieving it is that when we finally confess what we've done against you, we know that in you we find complete forgiveness. We are made anew in you, Father. That's why you came to the cross. That's why you died for our sins, to give us an advocate, to give us a hope. But Father, this morning, as we gather together and we hear your word preached, I pray that all of our hearts be open. And that whatever sin we're struggling with, whatever habit or attitude we're dealing with, my prayer this morning is that we understand the importance, as David did, of seeking you and making it right now. That we don't keep putting it off. Because guilt will eat away and eat away. Before long, we completely ignore your presence and we find ourselves in some spiritual danger. Father, my prayer also this morning is that if there is anyone here who does not know you, and for whatever reason they continue to put this off, I think it's very clear this morning from your word that now is the time for repentance. Now is the time to seek you, because we're not guaranteed tomorrow. I pray that the seed has been planted, Father, and that we're convicted to serve you with our whole hearts. Your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. David was not perfect, nor are we. And those three words are the hardest thing to say. We've all had moments where we've had to confess or admit something. And it's hard. But I cannot stress to you the relief that it brings when we finally acknowledge that we are sinners before the presence of God and seek to make it right. Whatever you're struggling with, whatever burden you're facing this morning, come before His presence. Seek Him. Be made right before Him, because He promises forgiveness. He promises restoration if we just humble ourselves and seek the cross this morning. I don't know what needs you have, but my prayer this morning is that you address it now and don't put it off for tomorrow. Let's stand and sing our hymn of invitation together.